Thank you so much for streaming our latest message from First Baptist Church. Here at FBC, our mission is to lead people into a growing relationship with Jesus Christ. We do that by thinking big, thinking small, thinking in, and thinking out. We hope that this message helps you as you continue to grow in your faith. If you would like to stay connected to FBC, you can visit our website at fbcloyd.ca, look us up on Facebook and Instagram, or download our free mobile app. Now here's the latest from FBC. Enjoy.
Hey guys, welcome here this morning. I hope that you're having an awesome morning so far. We are, as most of you probably know, in week three of our First Peter series. Doug covered chapter one the last 2 weeks and offered a lot of really cool insight and encouragement from that chapter of the Bible. If you missed it, it's awesome. I'd recommend checking it out on our YouTube channel or through the FBC app. And I just hope that over my weeks through this book that I can deliver on somewhat of a similar level that Doug has been, because I've really been enjoying taking it in. I had this like whole kind of intro talking about Peter prepared, but as I was practicing this week and timed myself, I was way grossly over time, so I cut the whole intro. So the one thing I do want to say, though, I do want to reflect on one thing about Peter. And just for those of you who don't know, we're working through verses 1 to 10 of chapter 2. You can pull it out on your Bibles or on your phones, or it's going to be on the screens, and there are kind of some outlines in your bulletin to follow along and take some notes if you'd like. Peter was a very huge and important figure in the establishment and the kind of the carrying out of the early church. A lot of what the early church was, which translates into how we do church now, started and was run by this guy named Peter. I think as people living in North America in the 21st century, it's really easy for us to think very individualistically. You know, when I hear things, myself included, when I hear things, when I process things, when I learn things, when I'm told something, when I take something in, what I think about is I think about Ryan, how that affects Ryan, what's important to Ryan, and what matters to me, you know? Very uncommon for me to hear something and think, oh, well, how does that impact the entire community around me? For sure, in a different cultural context back then, and someone who was very passionate about kind of a think big aspect, the aspect of big church, a corporate body of believers, a community, a collective whole. Very different, where he would be writing a letter saying, hey, this is more about how this impacts the community, how this impacts the corporate whole rather than just the individual. I think it's good to process things on an individual level. That's a think-in perspective, how we engage personally with God, and that's important. But I think as we read this chapter today, we're going to focus a lot on how really this works into being part of a bigger picture rather than just ourselves. So I'm going to ask us to kind of try to take off our 21st century North American individualism and try to think like Peter would think, or how he would hope his readers think as they process this. We're going to dig in, but I'm going to pray and then we'll hop into this. God, thank you so much for your love and for your words to us, God. You're an amazing God, and I just thank you. Ask that you'd speak to us this morning and you would continue to work in and through our church, God. Amen. Sorry, thanks for bearing with me this morning. I'm a little emotional, and I appreciate you guys bearing with that. I got Talcy and some of the youth boys to make me some funny pictures to look at if I start choking up a little bit, to kind of take my mind off that. So have a stack. I worked through a few in the first service, and so if you see me looking at those and kind of laughing to myself, that's what's going on there. So thanks for bearing with me. I want you guys to know, my grandma passed away, and yesterday, I want you to know Doug texted me, and he said, hey, I can take over tomorrow if you want, which I really appreciate, but I passionately believe that when we have an opportunity to talk about Jesus, we should take it. And I don't want many things to be an obstacle to that in my life, but I also want to recognize what an awesome mentor, pastor, friend, lead pastor we have in Doug, just being willing to say the day before, hey, I'll I'll cover for you. So anyways, I do appreciate you bearing with me a little bit this morning. Hopefully we'll get through this all right. Verse 1 of 1 Peter chapter 2. It starts off with this word, therefore. And Doug's passage last week started off with this word, therefore, as well. When you come to a conjunction like this, especially one that's dependent on the text that precedes what you're about to read, it's important to know what you've just read. So just to reflect on the last couple weeks, in chapter 1, Doug was talking about God's grace, his sovereignty, So his sovereignty being his rule, his power, his domain, how big and amazing he is. But his grace being how forgiving and loving and kind and full of mercy he is. And then also he talks about in chapter 1 how it kind of points Christians towards the hope that we can have and the fact that Jesus is coming back for us one day. That Jesus will return for us because he loves us and how much hope we can have in that. Doug said last week that the result of who Jesus is and what he's done is us getting to have a salvation, a relationship with God that has big consequences. There are consequences to being a follower of God. There's a job description that comes. It's not that negotiable. It's not a job description you write up on your own, but God hands it to you and says, now that you're a follower of me, now that we have a relationship, here you go. And it's so rewarding, but it is not an easy calling. Last week, Doug said, he made this quote, I love it. It says, simple faith cheapens Jesus' sacrifice for us. Simple faith cheapens Jesus' sacrifice. It's so true. If you're looking for a simple, easy, cheap faith, then you're looking for a simple, easy, cheap sacrifice on the cross from Jesus. That was a deep, difficult, complex thing. And as a result, faith is not easy. Being a Christian is not easy. If you think it is, then welcome to this series, and I hope that you can start to recognize some elements of your faith that shouldn't be so easy. But it's so rewarding. It's the best choice you could ever make. And Doug finished up last week by saying that Peter kind of ends with this assumptive close. He says, because of who Jesus is and how good Jesus is, like, obviously, we're doing this. He doesn't say, hey, you know, if you're interested, continue reading, think about it, you know, discuss it, find other answers on the internet, consider some other religions. It's like a good car salesman. If you go to a car dealership and the car salesman, they tell you all the good things about the car, how low the monthly payments will be over the next 100 years of your life, you know, why you need this car. At the end, they don't say, hey, maybe you should, like, go to the dealership across the road and compare prices or go online or ask your wife what she thinks. He's got paperwork drawn up and he's like, here, sign here. It's easy. We're done. It's Peter. He's saying, God's so good. Obviously we're doing this. So he continues on in chapter 2, and that's going to be our concern for this morning. Therefore, rid yourselves of all malice and all deceit, hypocrisy, envy, and slander of every kind. So this first verse could be an entire series. We could camp on that for a month or two. And kind of been laughing about it in the office because it kind of sounds like what our series in the summer is going to be kind of summed up there. You'll find that in the New Testament, writers who write these letters often list like a list of kind of seemingly sometimes kind of random sins. Like they pick out, you know, Paul here writes like this list of these ones, and Peter here, he has these five that he picks out: hypocrisy, envy, slander, malice, and deceit. And though when we read these letters, we don't really know why did he pick these five right now? What was going on? You know, did he just meet some malicious, deceptive, hypocritical, envious slanderer? And he's like, all right, those five, I'm putting them in my letter. I'm mad. I don't know. For sure, we know that Peter, we can read stories about him in the Bible, struggled with some of these on a personal level, but he also saw firsthand how some of these really played out on a corporate level in the community of believers that he was a part of. In Mark 10, you read the story, him, James, and John, they're kind of this three-man kind of inner circle with Jesus. They went and did like really cool things with him, and they hung out. And what happens is in Mark 10, James and John, they come up to Jesus and they say, hey, Jesus, when you set up your kingdom, what we want is we want a big throne on your left, a big throne on your right, and we want to sit on those thrones. We want position. So what happens? The other disciples, well, obviously they're ticked off. Probably part of it, they're envious because they're like, why didn't we think of asking for that first? So Jesus rebukes James and John, but it says that the other disciples, they become malicious. They start to slander them. They start getting mad at them. This spreads in their group because of this. So Jesus rebukes them all, and he says, you guys, you don't get how this works. You want to be great in my kingdom? You want to sit on a throne? Well, understand that there aren't thrones. Understand that the greatest position in my kingdom is to kneel down and wash the feet of a lowly person. You want to be great in my kingdom? Be a servant to the lowliest of people. Or as far as deceit goes, there's a story in Acts 5. It's one of the most, I think, one of the most intense stories in the Bible. It's not as intense as some of the Old Testament stories, but it's kind of more intense because it's in the New Testament, which kind of makes it scary because it's like, could that still happen? It's this couple named Ananias and Sapphira. Maybe you know the story. But what happens is Peter, he's running the church. The church is growing. There are tons of people, lots of cool stuff going on. And kind of this revival happens where people, they're like, let's just sell everything we have and like give all our money to the church, you know? And I just want to say you're welcome that we only encourage you to give 10% nowadays, okay? But they say, let's give everything. Let's give it to people who are in need. Let's make sure everyone's provided for. And so what happens, there's this couple named Ananias and Sapphira, and this is exciting. They want to be part of that. But they decide, hey, let's hide some of the money. Let's keep it. Let's lie about it to the church, okay? And so Ananias shows up, and he lies to Peter, shows up to the church, lies. And what happens next is crazy. God strikes him dead, just kills him. And I don't know why sometimes God deals with situations so much kind of seemingly severely than he does others. Like, I don't know. Like, I've lied in my life. Still alive. So I don't know why that happens, but it did. So they take Ananias's body out. And then a little bit later, Sapphira comes in. She doesn't know what's happened. She doesn't know that she's currently a widow. And she lies too, and God strikes her dead. And I'm thankful that he doesn't always do that. I do know that sin is always that serious to him. Deception is always that serious to him. I think we read a story like Ananias and Sapphira and we think, okay, so Ananias and Sapphira, this thing happened, but a few sentences later, you're reading a different story, so church continues on. And I want to stop and think about that for a second. Suppose today someone gets up, they throw some money in the plate, and they stand up and they decide, they lie to all of us. They're like, I gave this much, or I sold my house and gave it all. And all of a sudden they drop dead. What's not going to happen is I'm not going to say, okay, you guys want to play the next song? You know, let's keep going. Cool. So my third point is, you know, I'm like, guys, go home. Like, church is over for the day. You know? That messed me up. Peter's a human. I'm sure he was having trouble sleeping that night. Did Ananias and Sapphira have kids? I don't know. It's pretty intense. They probably had to set up like counselors in their church for the people. Like, I was at church the other day. People just died. Is that going to happen to me? What's going on? We have newcomers every week here at FBC. If you're one of them, welcome. We're so glad that you're here. Could you imagine? We give out a $10 Tim Hortons card to our newcomers to just say, hey, thanks for coming. Could you imagine? We couldn't give you $1 million Tim Hortons card if you watched someone drop dead on a Sunday morning because God struck them dead. You'd never come back. And if you did, I'd say you've got issues. This is not a church you'd want to come to if you saw that going. This would screw up what we call church, if people started dropping dead. Why? Because of their deception. We think that lying, dishonesty, slander, envy is a personal issue. Hopefully we can grow and work on that. It's not. It's a corporate issue. I mean, I haven't seen it play out that way, but I've seen it play out in churches in other ways, in families, small groups, communities of believers. It's not just your problem. It's all of our problem, the things that we struggle with. And not just this list. It has a serious impact. And Peter, I think, writes about these things having an impact on the community of believers, not just because he knows about it, but because he's experienced it firsthand. Like, I can tell you that, you know, drunk driving is dangerous. It takes lives. But if there's someone up here who's actually experienced that firsthand, seen that happen, lost someone to that, they could really tell you about that. This is Peter sending a warning to us, saying, guys, this stuff will jack up your church. You want to ruin things? Practice these things. Moves on in verse 2 and 3. Peter says, like newborn babies, crave pure spiritual milk so that by it you may grow up in your salvation. Now that you have tasted that God is good. I love this language. Now that you have tasted that God is good. What's it mean to taste God? Well, this is kind of a reference to Psalm 34:8, where David writes and he says, taste and see that the Lord is good. Blessed is the one who takes refuge in him. You know, we don't just invite you guys to say, hey, come and listen to Doug and me say that God's awesome. Don't just intellectually process that. Do intellectually process that, but experience it on a personal level, but also on a corporate level. You should be able to show up to God's bride, the church, to his family, the church, his body, and experience that God is good. Not just have people tell you he's good, but experience his love and goodness. And I hope FBC is a place like that. I hope FBC is the most welcoming place where people can taste and see that the Lord is good. If not, then what are we doing to contribute to that? There's this milk metaphor. It says, crave pure spiritual milk so that by it you may grow up in your salvation. I'm going to quickly say one thing about biblical language. Sometimes you'll see some themes throughout Scripture. You'll see that, you know, there's a metaphor that's used multiple times throughout the Bible, and sometimes in the same context, but sometimes in different contexts. And it's good to read it for what it's actually saying, because I think sometimes people are confused by this passage because of other things that the Bible says that aren't trying to mislead it. So here's an example of what I mean. The term morning star is used as a metaphorical reference in Isaiah 14 to Satan. So if you read Isaiah 14, it says morning star. If you read Isaiah 14, morning star means Satan. If you read Revelation 22, it says morning star again. But what's it a reference to? Jesus. Okay? So if you read Isaiah 14, you're like, morning star means Satan. You get to Revelation 22. All of a sudden, Satan's won. Very confusing. Another example is the term sheep. In Isaiah 53 and in Mark 6, sheep are regarded as helpless, lost, people who've gone astray. It's a negative thing. But in John 10, Matthew 25, different attributes of what sheep is a reference to followers of Jesus who hear his voice, those who have been saved. Maybe you've read, the reason I say that is because maybe you've read in 1 Corinthians 3 or Hebrews 5 where spiritual milk is actually a negative reference. It's saying, hey, you know what? You guys need spiritual milk because you're a bunch of babies that won't grow up. You can't eat solid food. And that's a negative there. One time Darren was talking about that at youth, and he had a sippy cup full of milk, and he had a Foreman grill out, and he was cooking a steak in front of all of us and saying, you know what, milk is for babies. You guys should grow up. This isn't what Peter is dealing with here. Peter's not using milk in that way, and so I say that to make sure that we're not taking a metaphor that Paul or another author uses to ruin what Peter's getting at here. Peter's saying, crave pure spiritual milk like babies crave milk. I don't know if you've met a lot of babies in your life. If you have, you'll know that babies can't do very much at all. They're basically helpless. In fact, I would submit that there's really only one thing they can do, and that's cry to let you know that they need milk, okay? I know there's some moms out there who disagree with me and say, no, Ryan, babies are good at snuggling. And I actually really disagree with you. I think you're wrong. And this is why I think you're wrong. Next time you're standing there holding your baby, snuggling, just let go. Stop. Yeah, someone's wearing their baby up here. Okay. If you're not using a wrap. Babies are good for snuggling, like your pillow is good for snuggling. But they're not good at snuggling. They're good at crying to let you know that they need milk. Why? Because they crave it, they depend on it, and they need it for growth. They rely on it for life. Matthew 5, Jesus tells us to hunger and thirst for righteousness. And if we do, we'll be filled. Peter's calling us here. He's not chastising people for needing milk. He's saying, like babies, need Jesus to fill you. Hunger and thirst for him. Depend on him. I also just want to say, moms in the room, please don't try that. I don't want lawsuits on my hand. And if there are babies in the room, I'm not trying to offend you guys. I hope you're not offended by that. So. As followers of Jesus, we need to crave that like babies do. Cry out. Say, God, I need you. We crave milk because we've tasted that God is good. And if we crave milk, then there's this result. And that is that we grow up in our salvation. Talked about this a little bit before. Salvation, in this verse, is a Greek word, soteria. And what this means is deliverance. A lot of the times when we talk about salvation in churches, what we think about is that moment at camp where you prayed that prayer, or that moment on a Sunday morning, or at that weekend trip, or with a friend that you know who loves Jesus, where you prayed and you said, God, I'm sorry for my sins. I want to start a relationship with you. I want to follow you. Don't get me wrong. That moment is so beautiful and so important, and probably the most pivotal moment in your life. I have that moment in my life, and it's so important. I don't want to undermine that, but what I want to say is that moment is a moment. It's a step in a lifelong journey of moments that we're called to seek out salvation. If you've never had that moment, on a side note, come talk to us. We'd love to pray with you today. Today is the best day ever for that. To come pray with us, ask God to forgive you and start a relationship with him. But in Philippians 2:12, Paul says, work out your salvation with fear and trembling. Here, Peter says, grow up in your salvation. Well, if salvation means deliverance, if soteria means deliverance, what's going on is he's not just talking about having this moment where you pray a certain prayer, or say some certain words, or do a certain thing. He's talking about being delivered from the evil that grips us, the darkness that we're going to be reading about in verse 9 that God has called us out of into his wonderful light, delivering us from that. And he says, as a result, taste and see that God is good as a result. Grow up in your salvation so that you can continue to be delivered from hypocrisy, envy, slander, malice, and deceit. You see, our church here in the world, we can't afford to be riddled with hypocrisy. Yeah, do we have some hypocrisy because we struggle? For sure. But we can't afford blatant hypocrisy. We can't afford blatant malice and deceit. That could have impacts that are more hazardous just than Ananias and Sapphira. We have to consider, for the collective good, how important it is for us to crave pure spiritual milk and grow up in our salvation. I'm going to take on a bit of a longer passage here, verses 4 to 8. As you come to him, which is a reference to Jesus, as you come to him, the living stone, rejected by humans but chosen and precious, but chosen by God and precious to him, you also, like living stones, are being built into a spiritual house to be a holy priesthood, offering spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God through Jesus Christ. For in Scripture it says, see, I lay a stone in Zion, a chosen and precious cornerstone, and the one who trusts in him will never be put to shame. Now to you who believe, this stone is precious, but to those who do not believe, the stone the builders rejected has become the cornerstone, and a stone that causes people to stumble, and a rock that makes them fall. They stumble because they disobey the message, which is also what they were destined for. So the main concern here is talking about stones, and in two different ways, mostly in a reference to Jesus and also to us. And so we're going to reflect first on what this is talking about Jesus here. It refers to Jesus as this living stone. He was rejected by humans, but chosen by God and precious to God. So often, and usually, what's precious to God is rejected by people. You know, we think that our cultural flow will get us somewhere good, but usually it's quite the opposite, where God sends the most chosen and precious thing to him, and humankind, our culture, would crucify that thing on a cross. This idea of laying a stone in Zion is a reference to Isaiah 28:6. Isaiah the prophet says, see, I lay a stone in Zion, a tested stone, a precious cornerstone for a sure foundation. The one who relies on it will never be stricken with panic. So Peter borrows the language here. Isaiah is a prophet in the Old Testament, and so he prophesies some stuff that's coming. He's kind of a mouthpiece to the people of God in the Old Testament. Isaiah 28 is what we call a judgment oracle. So an oracle is a portion of prophecy that kind of gives a warning or an idea to the people. And a judgment oracle is one where, you know, the prophet is saying something bad is coming. Destruction's coming. You guys have been screwing around. You're not doing what you're supposed to be doing. And as a result, there's judgment coming. So what's going on here is in Isaiah 28, you read it, and actually the prophet is talking to Ephraim. And so if you know your history, what's going on is there are 10 nations in the north here, Israel, because after Solomon, Israel split into two nations. So 10 tribes in this northern kingdom, Israel, and the southern nation, Judah, has two of the tribes. And one of the tribes in the northern kingdom is called Ephraim. He's one of Joseph's sons in the Old Testament. Well, what's going on is they've had all these kings and all these rulers who are bad, like they're doing a really bad job. And they're encouraging the people to worship idols, to worship pagan gods, and they're taking the people very, very astray. Their culture is dragging them away. And so what happens is Isaiah is saying, there's destruction is coming. And then he sends a warning to the nation Judah. He says, look at what's about to happen in Israel. Look at the judgment that's coming. You guys need to start getting your stuff together here and not end up where they're at. And if you know your history, in 722 BC, what happens is the nation Israel is exiled in a brutal exile by Assyria. And such a bad one that the tribes of the northern kingdom never really become tribes ever again. You know, I realize the nation is kind of there again, but not in the same way it ever was. And Judah doesn't take the warning. So in 586, they also have an exile. Maybe not quite as brutal, but they're exiled from their nation. And they're warned about this. But in the middle of this judgment oracle, what's cool is that God throws in this glimmer of hope like he often does. He's like, I'm mad. There are consequences coming. But still, for some reason, I love you guys. So I'm laying a stone in Zion. Zion is like this reference in the Old Testament that is a geographical reference that kind of means a few different things. It's a little bit of a confusing term, but it begins to expand into kind of a theological and spiritual reference that kind of references God's kingdom, his domain, his people, his work here on earth. And so, like, looking back now, we understand what he's talking about. He's saying, well, I'm going to send Jesus. He's going to be the cornerstone of this thing called church, and that's going to be his global work. When Isaiah was written, the people back then, they lived in what was called a theocratic system, where God is the ultimate ruler who gives them their law. It's a theocracy. And they would hear a prophecy like this and think, oh, God's going to build a big building. It's going to be a nationalistic thing. They're wrong, but the picture there that's really cool is how corporate it is and how real it is. With impending destruction coming, God still offers hope and says, even though you guys have gone so far astray, I'm gonna give you guys hope. One day I'm gonna do something. I've already started. The interesting thing I think about this is, like, in Israel, I'm sure there were some good people. I'm sure there were some people who followed Jesus, or, well, God, I guess, at that point, but they wouldn't know what Jesus meant. But there were some good people. But the corporate whole brought consequences. The lack of health of their nation brought consequences. What a cornerstone is it's the first stone laid in a building when they would build something. And so it's important partially because it carries weight, and we think about it being foundational, but it's also really important because every other stone is laid in a position that's in accordance with the cornerstone. So how the cornerstone is laid determines every other stone that's laid after that. So in essence, when you see a building built, you could step away afterwards and say, that building looks like that, it functions like that, it is the way it is, it's as strong as it is, dependent on what the initial cornerstone laid was. Jesus is this cornerstone, and the entire structure of who we are as a community of believers is positioned completely around that and can only reflect who our cornerstone is. Verse 7 and 8 says this. It says, now to you who believe, this stone is precious, but to those who do not believe, the stone the builders rejected has become the cornerstone and a stone that causes people to stumble and a rock that makes them fall. They stumble because they disobey the message, which is also what they were destined for. The Bible talks about there being two types of people in the world. And it sounds really just kind of harsh to just say there are two types of people in the world. But verse 7 reflects this, that there are people who believe in God, who have put their trust in God, who follow God, Christians, and there are people who reject God, who choose not to believe in him. And that's what verse 7 is talking about. And look at the difference of what this stone is. Jesus, the cornerstone, is to these two people. To one group of people, it's precious. This word precious is used a lot in this passage. It made me think I should, like, this week, guilty admission. When I was practicing, I tried to do like a sweet Gollum impression, but it was like just too embarrassing and awkward. So I decided to not, but you can picture me saying it like Gollum would say it. I would make you guys so uncomfortable if I tried. But it's precious to those who believe and put their faith in God. But to other people, it's judgment. It's a rock that causes them to stumble and a stone that causes them to stumble and a rock that causes them to fall. This idea of this cornerstone that the builders rejected is in Psalm 118, 22, which in your Grip 2.0 journals this week, you're going to be reading Psalm 118, which is this amazing poem about how God's love endures forever. And you'll hear that repeated again and again. And it has this reference to Jesus, this cornerstone that God is sending, but that people reject him. And this cornerstone stays the same, but is very different for those who believe in him and for those who don't believe in him. In English, there's this thing called an anthropomorphism. And what this is it's when we use human language or human ideas or characteristics to describe something that isn't so human, especially something divine like God. And so a good example of it is this. If you think about, if you're on the lake in a canoe and you're paddling, and if the wind is going the same direction as you, it's pushing you along, then you would say the wind is with me. The wind is with us. But if you turn your canoe around and you paddle the opposite way, it's a lot harder. You would say the wind is against us. So you're speaking of a change in the wind. However, the wind didn't change. The wind stayed the same. It was your position in accordance to the wind that changed. And this idea of being a stone or cornerstone is an anthropomorphism about who Jesus is. Jesus, the Bible says, is the same yesterday, today, and forever. But our position to him determines everything. Two types of people, those who put their faith in this cornerstone and those who don't. And the Bible is pretty clear that there's an eternal destiny for, That's awesome. It says toilet engaged, and it says, wow, huge congrats to toilet. I think it's, I don't know, okay. Oh, it's a cat, it says pew, pew, pew. That's funny, okay. That's doing a good job of distracting me. It's tough for me to talk about eternity right now, but it's exciting because I know where my grandma is in regards to this cornerstone. I know where her faith was, I don't know. She's a Christian. The Bible promises eternal hope in paradise with Jesus for those who put their faith in him. But the Bible also promises this eternal place called hell, judgment, punishment, separation from God for those who don't put their faith in God. I know we don't like to talk about that. I don't like to talk about that. Usually when we talk about heaven and hell, we usually say, you know, there's heaven, it's amazing, and then, you know, there's the other place, downstairs, whatever, and we kind of mumble away. And the Bible's pretty clear. I'd rather be real and uncomfortable with you about that. Think about it this way. This cornerstone, imagine the biggest rock you can think of, Mount Everest. Your position in regards to Mount Everest would make a big difference as to how Mount Everest impacts you. So for example, if you were to climb up to the top of Mount Everest, or preferably just get like helicopter lifted up there, because it'd be easier. If you were to go on top of Mount Everest, the view I'm sure would be breathtaking and amazing and beautiful. You would be able to see more than you've ever seen before. Your eyes, it would be like they were opened more than they've ever been before. But if you were to, instead of you going on top of Mount Everest, if you were to stand on the ground and we put Mount Everest on top of you, the result would be a lot different. It would be pretty uncomfortable, I would imagine. You know, it's like the sun. In June, it's awesome to be outside. Love the sun, you know? It's like, oh, it's warm. But if you put yourself in the middle of the sun, not so comfortable, not so nice. This is what Jesus is. He is the most amazing and precious thing in the world. He is this cornerstone on which we put our faith, and for those who put our faith in him, salvation. And if you're here and you're not a Christian, I'm not trying to freak you out. I'm just trying to be real about what the Bible teaches about who Jesus is. Because it says that Jesus is the same, but he is to some people salvation and eternal hope, but to some people judgment. Maybe you're here and you're a Christian. We should take that seriously when we think about those we know who don't put their faith in God. So judgment for those who don't believe. But we're going to contrast that to what it says Jesus is for those who do believe. Verse 9 and 10 says, you are a chosen people, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, God's special possession, that you may declare the praises of him who called you out of darkness and into his wonderful light. Once you were not a people, but now you are the people of God. Once you had not received mercy, but now you have received mercy. I'm going to talk really quickly about verse 10, and then we're going to jump back just a little bit. Verse 10, God's saying, you're nothing without me. I made you. Like, literally, I made you, but I also made you who you are. You guys were nothing. Now you are a people of God. You hadn't received mercy. You don't deserve mercy. But because of how good God is, he gives us mercy. He makes us his child. Okay, verses 5 and 9 are going to be the two last ones we look at. We've already looked at verse 5. We're going to jump back there a little bit. You also, like living stones, are being built into a spiritual house to be a holy priesthood, offering spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God through Jesus Christ. And then verse 9 says, but you are a chosen people. This is in contrast to people who don't believe in Jesus. You are a chosen people, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, God's special possession, that you may declare the praises of him who brought you, or who called you out of darkness and into his wonderful light. So much of the Bible is an invitation into the experience of who Jesus is. It's not just a call to go to church and find out who Jesus is and to like know info. I think knowing info is really good. I believe connecting with God intellectually is really good. But we're called to experience who he is. A disciple is someone who doesn't just know about someone else, but a disciple is a follower who follows the footsteps of someone else and experiences the things that that person goes through. They do the same things. They say, if my leader is experiencing this, then I need to experience that. This passage refers to Jesus as the living stone. And so Peter says, you also are living stones. Experience that. If Jesus was, then you as well. In Matthew 16, Jesus is talking to Peter, and Jesus tells him, I'm going to build my church. And the question is, why and out of what? And the answer is, us, living stones, positioned in accordance to Jesus, our cornerstone. Not in a way where you say, this is what I think church should look like. This is how I think it should sound. This is what I think church should do for me. But here's Jesus, the cornerstone. I'm going to fall in line and I'm going to position myself according to that and build this church that Jesus is talking about that's so good. And this call is not very individual at all. This call is this call is so good for the individual, but it's within thinking of a corporate sense of the church and what we can bring to the table and how we can contribute to this spiritual house that God is building. Chapter 5 says we're being built into a spiritual house. What an amazing opportunity. That's why we at FBC ask you guys to think big. Engage with us in our mission, because it's really just Jesus' mission to build the church. In our bulletins, we have this thing every week. Hopefully you've been checking it out, called the Think Big Opportunity. If you haven't, please do. Think big opportunity. It's a volunteer or a service opportunity. And we don't just put those in because we need to fill like a need or a void in our church, and we just need to make it feel like we're making people feel useful. I mean, yeah, we have needs. I'm not going to lie about that. We need you guys to do stuff. But these are opportunities. There's no greater opportunity that you can have than to use the gifts and the time, the energy that God's given you to be a part of being built into this spiritual house. It's uncomfortable sometimes. Sometimes we want to say, well, this is how I want to serve, or this is how I want to fit in. But you're not the cornerstone. So I don't think that's up to us so much. And maybe that sounds heavy. Probably it is. But that's kind of what it is. As you crave pure spiritual milk, as you grow up in being delivered, as you draw near to God, you contribute to the overall health of the church. Not just FBC. Not the other churches in town, but every church in the world is contributed, their health is contributed to by you as you continue to grow up in your salvation and become a healthier follower of Jesus. I've had kind of this crazy cold for like a month and a half. It hasn't been that bad or anything, but it's just kind of never going away. I don't actually even know what sinuses are or really what they do or what they look like. I know they're up here somewhere, but it's crazy. It's a little part of my body that I've never even seen or met, in a sense, or looked at. It's like, it gets sick, it just ruins everything, you know? Screws up my whole body. You know, like back aches because my sinus, it's like, back, why do you care what's going on with the sinuses? I don't know why it works that way, but it does. When we're unhealthy, the church is unhealthy. We contribute to the unhealth of the church. And I've seen unhealthy church situations, I'm sure a lot of us have. And when you're healthy, you contribute to the overall health of the church. So important to understand that craving pure spiritual milk and growing up in your salvation is important on an individual level. But we depend on you. We depend on each other to grow up in this sense. I just want to quickly look at this list of four things that were referred to in verse 9, and then we'll wrap up and get out of here. I know I've been talking for a while already. We're called God's special possession, a holy nation, a chosen people, and a royal priesthood in verse 9. God's special possession. God cherishes us. He loves us. He likes us. He enjoys us. Sometimes I don't know why, but he does. And a lot of times I think as Christians we talk about how Jesus died or how God laid a cornerstone or how God has done these things in the past, and we forget to talk about the things that God is doing right now. You know, God didn't just like establish the church and be like, peace out, you guys take over. I'll see you guys one day when I come back. God is at work. Hebrews 7, 23 to verse 28, you can read about Jesus, and he's kind of this metaphorical high priest of our church nowadays, and he lives for our church. He prays for our church, it says. He provides for our needs. He's at work. He cares not just about what he's done in the past, but what he's doing now in your life and in your church's life and what he will do in the future of this church. This is an amazing community of believers. And it's especially amazing because God's working here and now, and he'll be working tomorrow and next week and for years to come. We're a holy nation. You read in the New Testament how we're referred to as citizens of heaven. It often says, we're not citizens of earth, we're citizens of heaven. And you get this idea that we're connected to each other as followers of Jesus, that we have this connection that really can't be broken. I'm a dual citizen. I'm an American and a Canadian. In May, there's this idea that my dad and Talisi and I will go to Israel together. If I were to wear the flag of one of my citizenships, American or Canadian, on my backpack when I'm in Israel, the decision would be pretty clear. It won't change who I am. You know, but people say, don't wear an American flag on your backpack. Wear a Canadian flag. People like Canadians. Those people don't know who I am. It doesn't change who I am, what I put on there. But you get the sense that a collective whole represents the individual, and an individual often represents the collective whole. Who you are at work, in your family, school, when you're out, whatever you're doing, the social media you consume, the social media you share, what you say on social media, that's not just a reflection of you. That's a reflection of me, even if I don't know you. I don't know my sinuses. I don't know what they look like. But it impacts other parts of my body. It impacts the rest of us. It impacts FBC. It impacts the churches all around our town. It impacts the churches all over the world, and it reflects who Jesus is. The individual totally represents the collective whole, and the collective whole also represents the individual. That's why at FBC, we try our best to show our community that we care and that we exercise the love that God offers us. Because we reflect on who you are. You know, if you have an FBC bumper sticker or you use one of our nifty little shopping bags, we hope that people think that's a good thing because of who FBC is. We're a chosen people. God chooses us because he loves us. But God has also chosen us, and I kind of struggle with this idea sometimes because that's his strategy here on earth. And I struggle with that because sometimes I wonder if we're really the best strategy. But God's idea for how to reach people with his message, his good news, and his love is us. The weight, the burden, the responsibility of people hearing about Jesus rests completely on our shoulders as a church. People hear about Jesus through people. We just read through 2 Corinthians 5 in our Grip 2.0 journals a couple weeks ago, and it calls us Christ's ambassadors. It says that we carry his message of reconciliation. I don't know why God has chosen to, he doesn't need us, but he's chosen that the way that people hear about him is through us. That's our responsibility. He's chosen us strategically. And the last thing I want to talk about is this royal priesthood idea. It's kind of a weird term. I think we usually read that and we're like, what? In verse 5, it calls us a holy priesthood. It's royal priesthood. So first of all, royalty. Nowadays, when we think about royalty, if you want to become like a president or a prime minister, what do? You start a campaign, you join a party, you start a party, you make a Facebook page and an Instagram and a Twitter account. You need a Twitter account. And you raise lots of money, you spend lots of money, and you just try to get popular. You convince people they should vote for you, either by promising things or by saying how bad the other guy is, right? And then all that has to happen is lots of people have to pick you. It's a popularity contest, really. For a first century Jew, the idea of royalty, there's no way. They look back to their king David, who was promised his lineage would sit on the throne forever. The way you became royalty back then was you were born by a king and his wife. You didn't do anything to earn it. Back then when they heard this, they weren't like, oh, you know, it wasn't like kids were like, when I grow up, I want to be king. You know, the parents would be like, you can't, you know, because you're our kid, sorry. It just doesn't work. That's inherited because of who your parents are. And as children of God, people who are adopted by God, we're royalty and we should carry ourselves like royalty. Paul calls us to live a life worthy of the calling that Jesus has put on our life. The priesthood, the priests in the Old Testament were spiritual leaders. They're kind of this middleman between God and humans. Humans would sin, and then the priests were supposed to sacrifice animals for the people and say, hey, God, we're punishing the animal. Please forgive them of their sins. And God would say, okay. We know that Jesus came, he fulfilled that, so we don't have to kill animals anymore, which I'm really thankful for. I'm glad that's not my job. But priests, Now, in verse 5, the royal priesthood, the holy priesthood, are called to offer spiritual sacrifices. That's divesting yourself of who you are, your will, surrendering to God and saying, not my will, not my ideas, not my desires, but yours. I want to follow you. I want to be that type of a priest, that type of middleman that lays down my will so that people can be connected to you. And the last thing I want to talk about is how priests are called to be leaders. Malachi 2:7 is another judgment oracle, as we'll call it. What's happening is the priests aren't doing a good job. So God steps in and he talks to them. And he says, the lips of a priest ought to preserve knowledge because he is the messenger of the Lord Almighty and people seek instruction from his mouth. He's saying, priests, you guys are supposed to be messengers. People should be able to look at you and how you're following God and say, oh, I could do that and follow God as well. Like, if I follow along in the footsteps of that priest, I'll follow God. But he's saying, you're not doing that. What's wrong with you guys? I think one of the big problems we have nowadays, and maybe I'm wrong, but it was my impression growing up in church, is that at churches we have these guys called pastors. And sometimes they're pretty funny looking guys. But there are these pastors, and we read a text like this. We read about priests or a royal priesthood, and we think, this passage applies to my pastor. They are the messenger of God. They're the lips that preserve knowledge. They're the ones that should lead people to God. You know, if I just could get my friend to come to church, then the priest, the pastor, can tell them. I don't see anywhere in 1 Peter where Peter says, hey, listen, this passage only applies to you if your paycheck comes from a church. Just don't see that. This is written to all the churches across Asia, where Peter's saying this applies to everyone. A lot of the times, what's going on is that we think, oh, you know, this part's for pastors. You know, they play this bigger role. It's different. You want to know the difference between me and you guys? I'll show you what the difference is between us, besides the funny hairstyle. It's this. It's a bunch of wooden carpet that some people built when they built this church a long time. I don't know, like 400 years ago or whenever they built this church. Looks old. That's the difference. It's nothing. Peter isn't like, hey, if someone built some stage out of wooden carpet, you're called to be a royal priesthood. You should lead people to me. Paul invites people. He says, imitate me, follow in my footsteps, and if you do, you'll follow Jesus because I'm following Jesus. First, Peter calls us all to be a royal priesthood. We all have a stage in our life, whether it's been built by human hands or it's the job you have or where you work or go to school or the people you know. We all have this stage and we're called to be a royal priesthood. People that we can say, hey, if you follow me, you'll end up following God because that's what I'm doing. Follow my example. Follow in my footsteps. We have like 700 people here on a Sunday morning. Imagine if our picture wasn't, hey, the few staff that work at FBC, but 700 of us being a royal priesthood, adults, kids, I don't care how old you are, what you look like, being this royal priesthood, imagine what would happen in our town. I mean, it's awesome that there are 700 people here on a Sunday morning, but that means there are 29,000 people in Lloydminster that aren't. It's a big number. And if you think that Doug and me and the other staff are capable of reaching those 29,000 primarily on our own, then let me tell you, you have a way overinflated view of how awesome we are. Way. You were called and chosen and created to be a royal priesthood. The message of the gospel and who Jesus is weighs heavily on your shoulders. And I hope that your hearts are burdened by the fact that although it's awesome that we've grown and we have 700 people here, that we have 29,000 people that aren't. People you work with, everything like that. Let's be that royal priesthood that God calls us to be. Let's make that difference here in Lloydminster. Let's be a part of a corporate church where we step up and we say, yeah, follow in my footsteps. You'll see Jesus. That's a pretty heavy note to end on, but it's okay because we're all about to get a little heavier because it is Donut Sunday. So let me pray for you guys. Thanks for bearing with me this morning. I hope you guys have an amazing week. I'll pray for you really quick. God, thank you so much for this amazing church. Thank you that this church is yours, that your son is the cornerstone. Help us build ourselves into the spiritual house that you've called us to be and to position ourselves in accordance to who your son is and to be the royal priesthood that you call us to be, leading people every day to you. We love you so much, God, and we thank you for the work that you have done in our church and that you continue and will continue to do in our church. You're amazing. Amen. Have a great week, guys. Thanks for being here.